So hello friends, today we have Mitch Altman with us, and he's a great hacker and an entrepreneur. So we have him for this session regarding hardware hacking, and we hope that you enjoy this session with him. And I won't waste any time further, and let's begin with it. So hello Mitch.
Hello.
Yeah, so currently, Mitch is set up in Berlin, and we had a couple of chats previous to this session, but he was quite busy regarding his recent conference. And so, Mitch, how are things at your end, and what are you doing right now these days, and how was your how did the conference thing went? Yeah.
Things are going well for me here in Berlin. I'm spending most of my time the last few months of the pandemic learning German, since that's a fine focus during a time when you can't do too much else outside. So Berlin's mostly open, but yeah, learning German since I'm in Germany is a good thing. At the end of July, we had a 9-day conference called Hope Hackers on Planet Earth, which is normally 3 days in New York City live with 2,300 people, but this year was 9 days, totally online, with 40,000 people from 124 countries from around the world. And we had 117 talks and 59 workshops and 10 performances. And we had ways for attendees to interact with each other so we could all feel like there's a connection in this time when some of us, many of us, are feeling kind of disconnected. So, you know, that's what our conferences are all about, is bringing people together so that people feel good and learning and teaching and sharing.
Yeah, so that sounds great, and hope you enjoyed your time. So moving forward, guys, Mitch is the person that has a lot of experience with hardware, and I have attended a lot of his conferences in India and international. So I have got a lot of exposure regarding hardware through his workshops, and he always gives the workshops that are beginner friendly. So today we are having the session regarding hardware hacking. So when was the first time that you were introduced to hardware? Yeah.
Well, you know, since a little kid, really. my parents unbelievably encouraged me to take things apart in our apartment, and I wanted to see how things worked. And you know, and then they introduced me to one of their friends who does electrical wiring in houses and apartments, and he gave me a bunch of things to play with. And from there, I got a book from the library in third grade about electricity and electronics, and I kept that. And then I found someone in high school who taught me a lot just because he wanted to. And that was amazing. He brought a few of us high school kids together so we could learn from him and from each other and make projects and explore. So that's really what started me on my whole trip. I was curious about it, I played with it, and I had support along the way to continue to explore. So that was really important for me.
That's great, that's great. It sounds like the time when I was actually learning to run a bicycle, you were actually playing with the hardware. That sounds so amazing, and that's why you have a lot of... What was the best project or experience that you ever had with the hardware?
Well, that's not an easy question to answer. I've been to a bunch of conferences. The most exciting, of course, was my first one, when I was exposed to a whole world community of people who teach and share and learn with each other. And that's why I started helping organize these things, to make them available for more people who could benefit from this. And we all can, with community coming together to support each other. It feels really amazing. You know, and the first time I went to a hacker conference was Hope in 2006, Hackers on Planet Earth in New York, with 2,300 people. And I was amazed at all these people who loved doing what they were doing, and not just hardware, but also software, but also all sorts of projects, including art and music and stuff with food and whatever. Whatever people did, they were interested in sharing it. So that was super exciting for me. You know, there are so many things I could say about great hardware projects. You know, just for my own example, what totally changed my life for the better, among many other things, is doing this project that I really loved, which a lot of people in the world don't even understand, but there's enough people in the world who loved what I did. And I only did it for me because I loved it, but it turned out these other people love it too. And now I still make a living from it 17 years later, and that's TV Be Gone, a remote control that turns TVs off in public places, which is a really weird way to make a living. And I didn't plan that. It just happened because I was exploring what it is that I love doing, what was meaningful for me. And I don't like TV at all. I hate TV. I really hate TV. And turning them off gives me great pleasure. And now I make that available to other people so they can derive pleasure from it. And I also give workshops with many, many, many kits, including that one. And it's all open source. And I make it available as inexpensively as possible so that more people can benefit from it. And it's open source, so they don't have to buy parts from me or anything. It's all, they're all available all over the world. So get them any way you can, and you can learn this way. And it's really, really fun. And if it's exciting and you're interested, then you can continue to play and learn more. So that's really, again, what it's all about. And we can do that so well.
That sounds amazing.
With community. That sounds amazing. and that's why I do the community things that I do as well.
Yeah, so that is what open source is all about. So that sounds amazing. Like you're providing a project that has served a lot of needy organizations and people's need, and getting used in today's world itself. So what would you suggest in terms of best practices for them to make best out of it? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, this is true for any age, really. No matter how old you are, you can make time to explore what it is that you find meaningful doing, things that you really love and are passionate about. And most of us don't know until we make time to explore, because we were never taught that we should do that. We were never given the opportunity, really, to do that. So if you can make time any way you can, to explore what it might be that you enjoy doing, whether it's software, hardware, food, music, whatever it is, dance, you know, it's your life. Make use of your time doing things that are meaningful. And you can do that on your own, but we can do that much better with supportive communities. So if there's a hackerspace near you, then that's a great place to meet people of like mind and interests. And you can learn from them, and you can share what you know with them too, because we all, no matter how little we know, we have things we can share with other people. No matter how much we know, there's things we can learn from others. So that's really what we need to do. And that's of all ages. And we need to play. We play differently at different places and parts of our lives, but we need to play. It has to be enjoyable. And learning is enjoyable. Unlike, unfortunately, school, which often isn't enjoyable, playing is enjoyable. And that can be part of school. It can be most of school, even if schools became better. But that's certainly what we do in hackerspaces, and it's what you can do even on your own.
So this brings me to a small question that I would looking forward from you, is that how do you think that hackerspaces or makerspaces are making a lot of difference these days, and how do you think that they will be if there are more hackerspaces around
that
us,
will be more useful, that will be
and,
more
that
useful
bring, and that a lot of good a lot of good people and good projects out there.
Hackerspaces are important for a lot of reasons. Primarily though, it's community, and we all need community in our lives. They give people support for exploring and doing what it is you might like. And there are lots and lots of projects, almost all totally open source. And the plans are free, you can download them. But if you go to a hackerspace, there are people there who can help you with them. And by doing a project, playing with a project that you're interested in is a fantastic way to learn, perhaps the best way to learn, because there's a project that you're fascinated with and now you're motivated to learn what you need to learn in order to make that project work well. And once you're doing that, if you're still interested, then you can make it totally awesome and you need to learn more to do that. So that's a great way to learn. But if you do that, you might find that other people really love what you're doing too. If you find a project that's unique for you and what you're passionate about, what you love, what's meaningful, other people might find those same things. It's meaningful for them. And then it might be something actually worth starting a startup for, not just to make money to live on, but you can make money to live on a project that you love. That's very much a possibility. And I think that's the best thing for you and the community around you, because if it's really popular, you'll need help and you can hire other people, and it supports the broader community and it helps our economies. And it's, of course, it's good for education because we're all learning. So it's good for all of these different things. And all those things are super important for all of us, especially now during a pandemic. It might not be possible to all be together in one space anymore, but we can still come together with the technology we have available now. And hackerspaces are providing a need for people in the pandemic. There aren't enough materials in a lot of places in different countries in the world. So hackerspaces can get materials together and provide them to hospitals and medical people, or just low income people who couldn't afford it on their own, or who can't get them or make them on their own. So that's happening a lot at hackerspaces as well. A lot of cool stuff. If you don't know one, explore, just search for hackerspaces and your part of the world. You know, hackerspace Mumbai, you'll find some cool people. Hackerspace Akron, Ohio, whatever, wherever you are, you can find cool people at hackerspaces. And if there isn't one, then maybe you can help start one. Bring people together and see what happens. A lot of work, but it's really rewarding.
Yeah, that's a lot of information that you're sharing with us, Mitch. And thanks a lot for sharing that information. And I think that the culture of hackerspaces is something that is bringing a lot of new tech forward, and a lot of ideas are spreading. And I've seen that couple of incubators and Airbnbs in USA or in Europe, in Berlin, are getting converted into small hackerspaces wherein people are starting on with their own startups and they're working on their ideas. So this is something that is actually working out well. And during this pandemic, I think that the things that you discussed, that since we are not having any access to any hackerspaces anymore at this point of time, so open source is something that people should look forward into, and people should really work on their ideas and, you know, bring their projects hardware. So Mitch will be sharing a small session. So Mitch, why don't you tell us about a little bit about the session that you're going to conduct?
I have a bunch of projects that I have for teaching electronics for all levels, but I really love teaching total beginners who don't really know anything to begin with. So I make all of these projects, all of them open source. Everything I do is open source. I love sharing. Even the project I make a living from is open source, and that's partly how I make a living from it, because it draws more people in and people get excited this way. But all my projects are open source, and they're great for learning to solder, which is a great skill for doing anything in electronics. There are other skills as well, but that's a great one. And then once you build it, it works. And you can learn to debug if it doesn't work, of course. But it's easy to debug because the project is already designed and working well. And then you can also, by reading my documentation, or if you're in a workshop, learn from me presenting how it works. So I'll go over this one kit of mine, which is an electronic music synthesizer kit, an electronic musical instrument that can make lots and lots of incredibly different sounds and music that you can actually use to play with. You can solder it together and then it works. And I have lots of documentation and lots of different synthesizers that you can program into it. And it uses an Arduino as its basis. And that, for people who don't know that, it's a little board that you can program. It makes it really easy to program and connect parts to the microcontroller, the computer chip's pins, and to control those pins. Arduino makes that all really easy. So that's great for beginners. It's also good for people more advanced who want to learn how to make sound with computers. And so that's called digital signal processing. And the basics of that is actually quite easy to learn. And I make that easier by giving my documentation and providing it in a form that's fun to learn with. So that's called ArduTouch Music Synthesizer. It's an Arduino-based keyboard, music synthesizer with a touch keyboard. And it's also got a little amplifier and speaker, so you can make sound immediately after you put it together.
That sounds great. So we are looking forward for this session. So guys, we will be sharing the demo session and we are planning out a bunch of more videos regarding the hardware hacking and more about hackerspaces. But so there are a lot of people who actually students, majority of the students who actually want to pursue their, career in hardware. But the only thing that they are afraid of about hardware is that, if there is a bug inside your software, then it's more often that you are able to easily fix it because it's just a piece of code. But if there, something happens to your hardware, then things might go wrong.
So, like software, there's no easy, few steps that you go through to debug hardware. So you just have to learn by experience. Unfortunately, that's really the only way. It can be frustrating to debug, but it's also you learn so much and it's really satisfying when you figure it out, just like with software. It's just that there are different blocks and different tools available for hardware than for software. But it's basically the same process. You come up with a way to come up with an idea of what might be wrong, given what you know about the circuit. And then you come up with an idea to test your hypothesis. And you can make an LED blink at a certain part of the controlling software, which controlling program, which in hardware is called firmware. So just like a print statement in software to help you debug. And you can also try different things to see. But if the hardware isn't working at all, then you can see, does the power work? That's always a good first step, or an early step anyways. You can take out an ohm meter, which measures resistance, and see if the power is shorted out. You can try putting your hand near some parts to see if they're getting warm or hot. You don't want to touch them immediately because you might get a blister, and no one likes that. So, you can, of course, throw the board away and buy a new one, but that just makes toxic waste, and you don't really learn from that. So finding out which chip works and which doesn't by these various methods is good. And if you have a microcontroller, then you can do these things like blinking an LED by changing the firmware around. So yeah, trial and error. We learn from our mistakes. We learn from what works, what doesn't work. We learn from our successes as well. And then you're able to debug more easily as time goes on. But that's really the only way. Like learning electronics, learning to fix electronics is the same thing. We have to play with it. And the more we play, the more mistakes we make, and the more we learn how to fix them.
Yeah. So I think that will be it. And Mitch, thanks a lot for giving this session. And I will be giving the link down below regarding the project that Mitch was talking about and a few details about Mitch. So as we introduce Mitch, but I think we missed out a few things. Mitch has already given a few talks and sessions with Google and a lot of great tech conferences. So he was talking about Hope. So I will surely be linking a description and the link below about the Hope conference. And what are the things that you are planning now, Mitch? Once things get settled, or what are your future plans, or are you planning to come visit in India again? So just wanted to tell you guys that Mitch recently came here in India related to a tech conference, and he was a speaker there, and we actually enjoyed talking to him, and we are soon expecting him. So over to you, Mitch.
Yeah, I'd love to go back there. I love going to India. The community there is just really wonderful. It's really good all over the world, but India is a really unique place, and I really love it. And coming up in December is a really fantastic conference in Germany. It's called Chaos Communications Congress, put on by CCC, the Chaos Computer Club. And this year, they just announced on Friday that it will be only online, because bringing 17,000 people together live is not only illegal, but a bad idea. So everyone in the world can join in. And I encourage everyone to check that out. Just go to events.ccc.de and you can check that out. And I'm getting together with a whole bunch of people, as I always do, to put together a hardware hacking area. This time it'll be only online, so we're not quite sure what we'll do with it. But like with Hope, we did lots of workshops online and they were very successful. People really love them. And I love doing mine and other people love doing theirs. So yeah, let's bring people together as best we can in these times that we're living through. And and help each other and support each other. And we'll get through this and our lives will be better as a result.
All right then. So it was great talking to you, Mitch, and hope I will be sharing the link of this CCC event and Chaos Community Conference, and hope we'll be having a great time. So moving on, we'll be having a lot of great sessions and workshops with Mitch on the YouTube channel, and hope that you guys will enjoy it. So it was great having you, Mitch, and hope that you enjoyed the time as well.
I did, yeah. Thanks so much for having me. And I look forward to when we can be together again.